So in this session, we'll be working with the topics such as how transistor is going to operate. Okay, nothing but operation of a transistor. Okay, so transistor operation. Okay, so I do feel that the people do remember the fundamentals that we discussed in the previous session. Okay. So those fundamentals will be the basic building blocks in order to understand this session. Okay. So in case of this transistor operation, let me consider an NPN transistor. Let me consider the structure form of NPN transistor. So let me say that this is my block. Okay, I know that the width of collector is higher, width of base is less, and width of the emitter is medium. So this is how the blocks have been prepared. Okay, so I'm having three terminals out of this. So this is my emitter, this is my base, and this is my collector. Okay, so I'll just change the color. So this is my N region, P region, and once again an N region. Okay, so now since this is a N type of material, electrons are there. Electrons are there. Since this is P type of material, some holes are available. Then since this is once again N type of material, I'll be having the electrons. Okay. Now in order to understand how this transistor is going to operate, let me say that I'm going to operate my transistor in the active mode. I'm going to operate my transistor in active mode. Now, since I'm going to operate my transistor in active mode, then I need to take care of how I'm going to bias this particular transistor. How I'm going to bias this particular transistor. Now, if I want to bias my transistor in the active mode, then I know that. Yes. So this is my emitter junction. Okay. This is my base junction. So emitter to base, it should be forward biased. Emitter base junction should be forward biased. And collector base junction should be reverse biased. Yes or no? So now, if I want to forward bias this emitter to base junction, then I need to connect negative terminal. I need to connect a negative terminal to negative of the transistor, right? So N should be connected to the negative of the battery, and this positive terminal of the battery should be connected to positive end of the circuit. So now it means emitter base junction is forward biased. Emitter base junction is forward biased. So now we'll see how we are going to bias this base collector junction. Now in order to reverse bias this, my basic intention is to reverse bias this. So in order to reverse bias this junction, what I should do? So here N is there. I will connect the positive terminal of the battery. I'll connect positive terminal of the battery. So here I'm having P side. I'll be connecting a negative terminal of the battery. Okay. Now this potential. This potential I call it as VEB, nothing but emitter base voltage, emitter to base voltage. And this terminal, I'll be calling it as VCB. That is collector to base voltage. Okay, so now, in order to understand this operation, so we should know that two junctions are formed into this transistor. So we know that this is our junction J1 and this is our junction J2. This is our junction J1 and this is our junction J2. So to understand this operation, let us first understand why this is said to be as BJT. Okay, so this might be a little bit revisiting of the concept which has been discussed in the previous session, but it is important. Other than this, you will never understand this concept. So now here we are saying that the B stands for the term bipolar. B stands for the term bipolar, wherein it indicates that we are having two charge carriers into the circuit. So one being the electrons and second one being the holes. Electrons being the negative charge carriers and holes being the positive charge carriers. Right? Am I right? Then I am saying that we are having the term something called as junction because we are having two junctions in the circuit. So one is junction J1 and one more it is junction J2. So we are having two junctions J1 and J2. Then this term T stands for a transistor. So transistor, as I said you people, transistor is being coined as it operates transferred resistor. Transferred resistor. Okay, so what is this transferred resistor? So this transferred resistor means, as we have interacted already, so whenever I'm operating this transistor in the active mode, please remember this point, whenever I'm operating my transistor in the active mode, at that time what happens? Junction J1 will be forward biased. So junction J1, this is my junction J1, this junction it is forward biased, and this is my junction J2 which is reverse biased. So junction J1 is forward biased, junction J2 is reverse biased. Now when junction J1 is forward biased, it means what? It allows the electrons to flow through it. It allows the electrons to flow through it. So what does this mean? The resistance offered by this junction is almost equal to zero. So this is my ideal case. It's my ideal case. Similarly, this junction J2, which is being reverse biased, it offers a resistance which is almost equals to infinite, which is once again I'm treating it as an ideal case. Now, when I just see how is this resistance seen, So now let me say that when I'm forward biasing my junction J1, so this is my resistance. I call it as small r, and I assume that some current I is going to flow through this. Okay, then the same resistance on the output side, what is happening? I'm having a resistance whose value is high. This value r is almost equals to zero, and the value of this r is almost equals to infinite. So here again, I am having same value of I which has been flowing through this resistance R. Now, if I see what is the voltage drop across this resistor, then let me say, since it is on the input port, I say that this is the input voltage, which is the voltage drop across this resistor. Similarly, if I see what's the voltage drop across this resistor, so this is an output voltage, because this is there on the output side. Okay, now since I know from the Ohm's law, voltage across resistance is being given by V is equals to I into R. This is my Ohm's law. So if I keep I constant, it simply says my voltage is directly proportional to R. If R increases, voltage also increases. So when I compare this resistance with this resistance, I can simply say resistance on the output side is increased. Now since resistance on the output side is increased, it simply says that this implies my output voltage will be greater than input voltage. So So this is how we say that transistor works like an amplifier in active mode. Now we can understand, we said that my R is zero. From that equation, this Vi should become zero. In reality, this is not zero. This will be in terms of milliohms. So it means your input voltage will be in terms of some millivolts. Your input voltage will be in terms of some millivolts. Now your output voltage will be some volts. So it means we are converting a signal, or you are converting a weak signal. Let me put it like this. You are able to convert a weak signal into a strong signal. Here the amplitude of the signal might be in terms of millivolts, and that you are able to convert it in terms of the volts. This is what you are calling it as your transistor working like an amplifier. Okay, is it clear to you? So now, once if this term is clear to you people, now we will understand that. When I have forward biased my junction J1 and reverse biased junction J2, now I should know that the electrons, this is going to travel. Since junction J1 is forward biased, this electrons from this N region, they travel to this P region over here. Okay, because this junction is forward biased, so this junction is not offering any resistance. I hope my statement is clear to you. This junction is not offering any resistance. So let me say it like this. Assume that this is your junction and this is your electron, and your electron wants to travel. Now since this junction is forward biased, it means this junction is not offering any resistance. It is allowing this electron to move. So this electron is moving from your N side to this P side. Understanding? So there is free movement of mobile electrons. Now, what is that you people need to understand over here is one important topic. That is, when it comes to doping of the base, so this base region, it is very small. First thing, this is a very, very important point that you should remember. The base section is very small and it is lightly doped. It is lightly doped. Understanding? So these two terms, they are self-explanatory about the next process. Now since I'm having two junctions, let me say this is my junction J1 and this is my junction J2. So I'm having two junctions and I'm having a mobile electron or a free electron which is going to travel. Junction J1 is forward biased, so junction J1 is not going to offer any resistance. So it's as good as junction J1 is not there in the picture. And this electron is traveling. Now since this base is very small and it is lightly doped, now what happens? This junction, this electron is going to break this junction J2 and come and sit in this collector region. Understanding? So it simply means here the velocity of your electron is very high. Velocity is very high. What does it mean? It means the kinetic energy is very high. Because of this reason, most of your electrons will travel from your emitter and get accumulated in the collector. Most of the electron from your emitter, they travel and they get accumulated in the collector. Understanding? Okay. Now, as you are able to understand that this electron E minus, it is traveling, breaking the junction J2 and getting collected on the collector side. Okay. Now, let us see what are the current directions, how we are going to denote the current directions. Now, when I see electron moving from N region to P region, So how is electron traveling? Electron is traveling in this direction. Electron is traveling in this direction from emitter to base. Then how will be the current flow? Current flow will be in reverse direction, that is conventional current. So in that case, how do we show your IE? IE is shown in this direction. So this is your IE. Understanding? Is it clear to you? Then, since we are having some small amount of holes, because this is a p-type of material, okay? So as we know that this electron, it is traveling with a very high intensity. Since this electron is traveling with a very high intensity, so and as this base space is very less, only 2% to 5% of electrons involved in recombination. I simply mean to say, electron hole pair, whatever is going to happen, so it happens only to 2 to 5%. And remaining percentage of electrons, they get accumulated on the collector. They get accumulated on the collector. Is it clear? Now since the electrons from this side, they are traveling from your base to your collector. Now the direction of a base current will be like this. This is the direction of your base current, because the electrons are moving in this direction. Then when it comes to this collector, now these electrons which were traveling from your emitter to base, now they move from base to collector. That direction is same. They are going to move from base to collector. Now since direction of electron is like this, it means direction of collector current will be reverse to the flow of the electrons. So this will be your IC. So it means my IE current is shown like this, IB current is shown like this, and IC current is shown like this. It's a very, very important point, an important concept. How is the directions of current being shown? So whether if this concept is known to you, you can draw the current directions for any configurations. Understanding? You should just identify how electrons are flowing, opposite to that will be your conventional current. Understanding? Okay. Now let me say that this is the zeroth voltage. This is a zeroth voltage. Okay. And this is my junction J1. This is my junction J2. Now let me say I have not applied any voltage. So when I have not applied any voltage, so no electrons are going to move. It means there is some barrier voltage. So there is some junction J1 also. There is some junction J2 also. That is, this is stopping the electrons to move ahead. Even this is also stopping some electrons to move ahead. Understanding? So because of this barrier voltage, let me say that barrier voltage V equal to VB. So VB is the barrier voltage. So let me indicate that barrier voltage like this. So this is VB. What is this VB? This VB is nothing but barrier voltage. Okay, or you can even call it as junction voltage, not a problem. Okay, you are having very alias name in order to call this barrier voltage. Okay, now what I'm doing over here to the emitter to base junction, I'm forward biasing this. So since I'm forward biasing this voltage, what is happening to this junction voltage? Junction voltage is getting reduced. Now since I have forward biased, this junction J1, this barrier voltage is going to get reduced from a level VB to a voltage level, which I can say VB minus this potential, VEB. VB, because this junction is broken. So if at all if this junction has to get broken, then this voltage has to get reduced. It means this was my junction, this was my voltage that junction was offering. Now since this junction is forward biased, so this voltage is going to get decreased. Now, counterpart on this junction J2 side, what is going to happen? Since I am reverse biasing this, this barrier voltage is going to increase from a level VB to a level, So this voltage level, I can call it as VB plus this voltage, VCB. So it means on the base to collector side, your junction voltage is increasing. Okay, but on your emitter to base, what is happening? Your junction voltage is decreasing. Simple reason, emitter to base is forward biased and base to collector it is the reverse biased. Understanding? Is it clear to you? Now since this is forward biased, so more amount of electrons are going to come out of this emitter side. So emitter is going to emit more number of electrons. Let me say that n number of electrons, don't feel this is n type of material. That n type of material is indicated by this n. This n is indicating number of electrons ejected from emitter. So n is the number of electrons ejected from the emitter. Now if n is the number of electrons ejected from the emitter, we say that 1 minus alpha n is the number of electrons on the base. Okay, 1 minus alpha n is the number of electrons on the base, then alpha n is the number of electrons on the collector side. Okay, alpha n is the number of electrons on the collector side. Now, in order to understand this equation, how I am able to write n, 1 minus alpha n and alpha n. So I'll make you understand this concept over here. You treat your semiconductor material as one node. Okay, you treat this semiconductor material as one node and you apply KCL at that node. So if I apply KCL at that node, as per my law of KCL, it states that at a node, summation of incoming current should be equal to summation of outgoing current. Am I right? Now, so since I am treating this as one node, since I am treating this element as one node, so here I am having one outgoing current, which is nothing but IE, which should be equal to summation of incoming currents. So I am having two incoming currents, which is nothing but IB plus IC. So it means by applying KCL, I am getting the equation IE is equals to IB plus IC. So this is one of the important equation that we'll be using it for a very long time, whenever until unless we're discussing this transistors. Okay. Now, next concept that I would like to see over here is, now in case of this transistor, as I said you that if at all n number of electrons are going to be ejected from your emitter, then I said you very small percent of the electrons involved in recombination at the base terminal. Now I simply mean to say only 2% to 5% is the electrons which involve in recombination. On other side, the inverse of the statement says that 98% to 95% of electrons, they go to collector. Understanding? This is what is my meaning. This is what I am able to write 1 minus alpha n. I hope you are able to understand it. I'm able to simply say that, let me say, if 100 number of electrons, if 100 number of electrons are being ejected from the emitter, then only two electrons are available on the base. It means 98 electrons ejected from the emitter are there on your collector. Understanding? Is it clear to you? So this is very, very important part that one should remember. This is a very, very important topic that one should remember. It's a very deep understanding of the topic, in practice speaking. Okay. Now, there is one topic that is going to be, I can say that we can include in this interaction. Since we are saying that this is a bipolar component wherein we are having two types of charge carriers, both the I can say your minority charge carriers as well as majority charge carriers. So majority being your electrons and minority being your holes. Now, when this has been reverse biased, that is the junction, when it is junction 2, when it has been reverse biased, some holes, they are going to contribute in terms of a reverse current. Since this is N type of material, okay, so here minority charge carriers are holes. So since this is P type of material, minority charge carriers over here, they are the electrons. Okay, so this holes and these electrons, they contribute in terms of a reverse current. So I can simply say that the reverse saturation current, so for your understanding, I'm writing this, your reverse saturation current, which is also called as a reverse bias current. Normally we call this as a leakage current. Okay. We normally denote it by ICO. Where this I is standing for current, C is standing for, it is a current wherein collector terminal is responsible for it. So this term C is standing for collector. And this current, I am getting it when the junction is open circuited. This O is standing for when the junction is open circuited. So it is indicating the minority current. As I said to you, that this junction J2, it has been reverse biased, and few holes from this material and electrons from this material, that they are going to recombine and they are going to develop a reverse saturation current. Understanding? Now, if at all, if I want to write what is the total current on which is available on the IC terminal, that's nothing but the collector terminal, or I can say that collector current is being given by alpha times that of IE, plus ICO. Understanding? Now, what is this IC? It is the current which is seen on the collector terminal. What is alpha times that of IE? Alpha times that of IE is talking about the number of electrons seen on your emitter terminal. Number of total electrons seen on the emitter terminal. What is ICO? It is leakage current or reverse saturation current. Okay? It's a leakage current or a reverse saturation current. So this is a very, very important equation which we have derived it. Okay, is it clear to you now? So these two equations one should remember. One is IC is equals to alpha times IE plus ICO, and one more equation that we have derived it, saying that emitter current is equals to the base current plus the collector current. Okay, so these two equations, they are very, very, very important whenever you want to discuss the concepts related to the transformer. sorry, transistor. Okay, the concept related to your transistor. Fine. Is it clear to you? Okay. Any doubts in this topic? Any doubts in this topic? Okay. So now we'll take this session ahead, discussing what are the configurations in which my transistor can be operated. Okay. What are all my topics in which my transistor can be operated? So configurations of operating a transistor. Okay. So configurations of, this is my next topic, configuration of my transistor. Okay, configuration of this transistor. So normally we are having three type of configurations in which my transistor can be operated. One, it is called as common base. Second one, it is called as common emitter. And third one, it is called as common collector. Okay, common base, common emitter, and common collector. So out of these three configuration, common emitter is the one which will be using it in many of the applications because of the advantages that it is going to offer us. Okay, however, we are going to discuss in detail what is common base, how transistor can be used in this configuration, how transistor can be used in common emitter, how transistor can be used in common collector. After discussing all these three topics and discussing how transistor works as an amplifier and the relation between alpha, beta and gamma, then we'll go to the concept voltage divider circuit. We'll start the syllabus, voltage divider circuit. Because without understanding the topic of common base, common emitter, common collector, you cannot appreciate the topic voltage divider bias. Okay, because drawback of this is overcome using your voltage divider bias. Is it clear to you? Okay, so at this junction, you people need to understand that we are having three configurations in which our transistor can be operated. That is common base, common emitter, and common collector. Out of these three configurations, I am going to use common emitter. So this has been used in most of the cases because of the advantages that it is going to offer to me. Okay, so now, so we'll start our interaction with the topic common base operation of transistor. Common base operation of the transistor. Okay, so I'll share you the new link.